Welcome to St. Mary's Church Online for this morning prayer service on the second Sunday of Lent. Our theme for today will be From Suffering and Shame to Salvation. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We pray the collect for today. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, that they may reject those things that are contrary to their profession, and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. What I like about the collect we just prayed is that it links truth with justice. When we talk about truth and error, what we believe is important, as long as justice and mercy guide us. And by the way, when this collect speaks about our profession, it doesn't mean our line of work, but it means what we openly believe, what we confess. And we pray that our behavior will match those words and beliefs. Now, during Lent, some churches skip the confession and absolution in their services. They reason that the whole period of Lent is one big soul-searching exercise and confession. Now, I have intentionally left them in the liturgy for today, as we will be talking about shame. Perhaps we feel ashamed, or we feel vicarious shame, even more often than we feel outright guilt. These two emotions are very similar. In both cases, it will help to confess them before God. Because confession is not only about transgressions, it's also about all areas in which we feel inadequate, or helpless, or defeated, or ashamed, for whatever reason. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So we turn away from our sin and shame and helplessness and turn to Christ, confessing them in penitence and faith. So let us become quiet for a few moments as we reflect on the past week. And together we pray, Lord God, we have sinned against you, we have done evil in your sight, we are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoings and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw us to himself and cleanse us from all our sins, that we may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Gospel reading for today is taken from the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 8, beginning at verse 31. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels." Let's break up this text into three pieces: suffering, shame, and salvation. The first part of our text marks a huge change in Jesus' ministry. So far, his followers had regarded him primarily as a teacher, a rabbi, probably an enlightened one. But just like many wisdom seekers in our time, they assumed that enlightenment comes with some sort of immunity against suffering. Suffering would either not be the Messiah's fate, or it would somehow not touch him. All suffering takes place in the mind, they say, and is caused by desires and attachments. That's also the popular version of Buddhist teaching we so often encounter today. And I'm not saying that's what Buddhism actually teaches. But in any case, Jesus says, no, suffering is a key part of my mission. To want me to run away from it, that is temptation from the devil. It may sound wonderful and divine to escape and transcend all suffering, but it's actually earthly, not divine. It's the cult of achieving an elusive perfect health and happiness at all costs. The cult of trampling on losers. We can see it even today, this false idea that we can avoid suffering by following orders. But the recipe keeps changing and the suffering stays. Jesus spoke openly about the suffering he expected to have to face. And he was absolutely right, because he knew what people were capable of and would do to him. It was not a dramatization, but something he could clearly see coming, and it would cause him to suffer. You know why? Because you can have desires for yourself, but you can also have desires for others. And Jesus was not in it for himself. His mission was to save people. And Jesus knew that by rejecting him, the majority of his fellow Jews would mainly cause harm to themselves. They could have been reconciled with God and have their mission renewed, but they threw it all away. And that was probably the most painful for Jesus, that many would regard his message as nonsense and his sacrifice as meaningless. Today, the concept of the suffering servant, one of the titles of Christ, is still a difficult one. We like to follow heroes, people who can make our country great again, or tell us how to avoid suffering. So when it comes to Jesus, what are we attracted to? His victory over death, and perhaps his miracles, his miraculous powers, but perhaps less so to this strange vulnerability and altruism. And this is where shame may come in as well. As Paul wrote to the Corinthians, the crucifixion and all this talk of suffering was a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. And we too may find it difficult to explain and to defend these things. So let's have a closer look at shame. It's often mentioned in one breath with guilt, but it's actually quite different. When you are guilty, that's always bad. When you are ashamed of something bad, that's actually a good thing. It would be bad if you had no shame at all. But shame can also be misplaced. Some of us may have been made to feel shame by our parents or friends when we weren't actually guilty of anything. We can be ashamed of our body, of being not so good with computers, anything really. It's often caused by nothing more than the opinion of other people. And Christ wants to free us from that burden. Other people shouldn't have such power over us. Jesus also shows how inconsistent shame can be. The same people who were ashamed of being associated with Jesus were not ashamed of their adultery and other sins. To be ashamed of Christ is not logical either, because if anyone was not guilty, it was Christ. Hence his stern rebuke to Peter and his insistence that we take up our cross and follow him. Taking up your cross, perhaps that's for a large part accepting that people will often not take you seriously. Think of today's culture of naming, blaming, and shaming. It gives people a weak excuse to stop listening to each other. Do we seriously want to be a part of that? I hope not. So what solution does Christ offer? Could it be that what we tend to resist is at the same time our remedy? At the start of the second lockdown, a professor in mental health, Ernst Bollmeier, said something very interesting. Many people think that life always has to be fun and happiness, but that is the quickest way to depression. Happiness is not something to concentrate on. It's better to do something that matters to you, so that you can be satisfied about that afterwards. So when Jesus speaks of self-denial, this is also not about denying your principles and talents, but about that false glittering image that we project, that many of us like to present on our Facebook wall, for instance. And taking up our cross is about accepting our inevitable limitations and failures, including those imposed by a history that we cannot change, and by our environment. Acceptance doesn't mean we always have to agree with our circumstances. We can still work for change, and we must do. But like Christ, we are bound to encounter opposition and indifference. So be it. It shouldn't define us, positively or negatively. Let's dare to be different, to follow Christ, learn from him during this period of Lent, and ultimately share in his glory. Amen. Let's pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Be with us, Spirit of God. Nothing can separate us from your love. Breathe on us, breath of God. Fill us with your saving power. Speak in us, wisdom of God. Bring strength, healing, and peace. The Lord is with us. God's Spirit is with us. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, rest upon all of us and remain with us now and always. Amen.